Good evening. This is a good thing for us to gather together for. I'm really glad you're here. I think the Holy Week journey for many people of faith is kind of a secret thing. Before, it wasn't part of my regular growing up years, and now it's hard to imagine not being present during Holy Week. A lot happens between Palm Sunday and Easter. And without the stuff that happens, we can unintentionally diminish the power of what happens on Easter. And so this is a good way to join together. Tenebrae, it's a weird word. I think darkness is how it's usually defined. And so we'll notice in this service, if you haven't been a part of it before, we hear the seven last words of Christ in word and song. And after each word, a candle is extinguished. The lights in the sanctuary will slowly go off until we are left with Christ's death. And the Christ candle will, we won't extinguish it, that will leave the room, and then it will come back as we are singing together. This service will also end in silence. This community doesn't do too well if there isn't a benediction at the end. So we're gonna try it again. There won't be a benediction at the end. It's just silent, and we'll leave, and we'll begin our vigil, Easter Saturday vigil, the time of waiting for Easter. Last note before I read the introduction. I need a couple of greeters for 9 a.m. and 11 a.m. on Sunday, and we also need a couple more communion servers, both at 9 a.m. and 11 a.m., so you can catch me after if you might be able to serve that way. On this day, almost 2,000 years ago, the friends of Jesus were crushed, disillusioned, frightened, we might say, in a state of shock. For nearly 3 years, they had followed their leader, Jesus, whom they had grown to love and whom they had come to believe to be the Christ, the promised Messiah. But now, suddenly, everything had gone wrong. Things had happened so quickly. On Thursday, Jesus had still been with them. They had a solemn but wonderful evening together in the upper room of a friend. But by 9 o'clock the next morning, he was already hanging on a cross set on a hill called Calvary, which was just outside the city of ancient Jerusalem. In their shock and disbelief, at least some of them quietly gathered at the foot of the cross. Mary Magdalene and Mary, the mother of Jesus, were there, along with John, the beloved disciple. We would like to believe all the disciples made their way to Calvary on that day to be with Jesus in his last moments of suffering. Ever since that day, the friends of Jesus, those who believe him to be the promised Messiah, the Savior of the world, have gathered together to remember. In great thankfulness, we go to Calvary to kneel in the shadow of the cross. It is there we contemplate his suffering, so that we may never forget the awful power of sin, and that we may come to better understand why there had to be such a day as this at all. We who are counted as friends of Jesus have gathered beneath his cross again tonight. Here we kneel in humble thankfulness to God for the sacrifice, suffering, and death of Jesus. Let us pray. Dear Father in heaven, we thank you for this evening hour As we recall the events which happened on Calvary that first Good Friday, the story we know so well, but we love to hear it again and again. Send your Holy Spirit to refresh and enlighten us and to impress upon us once again that Jesus was nailed to that cross in our place. Rekindle our love and inspire us to show our love by following the footsteps of Jesus back into the world. In his name we pray. Amen. Let's read Isaiah 53 responsively. For he grew up before him like a young plant, and like a root out of dry ground. He had no form or majesty that we should look at him, nothing in his appearance that we should desire him. He was despised and rejected by others, a man of suffering and acquainted with grief. And as one from whom others hide their faces, he was despised, and we held him of no account. Surely he has borne our grief and carried our diseases. Yet we accounted him stricken, struck down by God, and afflicted. But he was wounded for our transgressions, crushed for our iniquities. Upon him was the punishment that made us whole, and by his bruises we are healed. All we, like sheep, have gone astray. We have all turned to our own way, and the Lord has laid on him the iniquity of us all. He was oppressed and he was afflicted, yet he did not open his mouth. Like a lamb that is led to the slaughter, and like a sheep that before its shearers is silent, so he did not open his mouth. By a perversion of justice he was taken away. Who could have imagined his future? For he was cut off from the land of the living, stricken for the transgression of my people. They made his grave with the wicked and his tomb with the rich. Although he had done no violence, and there was no deceit in his mouth.
The crucifixion of Jesus was preceded by a time of great physical and emotional stress. He was mocked and beaten. The flogging was with a short whip which had metal balls and sharp pieces of sheep bones tied at intervals to leather thongs. On his bare back and legs, this left deep wounds and strip-like lacerations. This obviously inflicted intense pain and much loss of blood, leaving Jesus in a much weakened condition. The Romans had perfected the crucifixion as a form of torture and capital punishment designed to produce a slow death with maximum pain and suffering. It was especially disgraceful and cruel, reserved only for slaves, foreigners, revolutionaries, and the worst criminals. It was customary. Jesus was forced to carry the crossbar, which weighed about 100 pounds. It was balanced on the back of his neck and shoulders and outstretched arms tied to the bar. Jesus was unable to manage the uphill walk, about one-third of a mile to the crucifixion site, which was aided by a passerby. Jesus would then lay on the ground, and tapered iron spikes 5 to 7 inches long were driven through his hands into the wooden crossbar. Then Jesus, nailed to the crossbar, was lifted to an upright post, making a cross. Next, his feet were crossed, one on top of the other, had a similar spike driven through the arches of his feet to the upright post. To accomplish this, his legs had to be bent at the knees and rotated to one side. This, of course, took away any possibility of Jesus supporting his own weight with his legs. Adequate breathing required that Jesus lift himself up by pushing with his feet and pulling with his arms against the iron spikes. This respiratory effort would quickly become agonizing and exhausting. It eventually led to his death, likely by asphyxiation. Survival on the cross varied anywhere from 3 to 4 hours to 3 to 4 days. Death was sometimes hastened by the breaking of legs and thrusting of a sword through the chest.
The first word, What would Jesus say from the cross? Anything at all? His suffering was intense. Have you ever felt great pain and then tried to express yourself? It isn't easy. About all one can think of is the terrible pain and finding some relief. And yet Jesus did speak from the cross. In fact, according to the gospel story, he spoke 7 times. What he said gives us a good idea of what he had in his mind and especially in his heart. The first word of Jesus from the cross shows us that beyond his intense pain, he was still thinking about others, those he came to save. In the midst of great suffering, Jesus was not thinking about his family or friends who were frightened and crying below the cross. Rather, the first thoughts of Jesus on the cross were for his enemies, those who had arrested him, mocked him, beaten him, pounded the nails through his hands and feet, and hung him on the cross to die. Father, forgive them, for they do not know what they are doing. These words tell us a great deal about Jesus. These words show us what kind of a Savior we really have. We sin every day. We think, say, and do things which hurt. Words and actions can hurt those we love, including Jesus. It was those very things that put him on the cross for us. Yet we discover that even when we know what we are doing, Jesus is praying to the Father in heaven to forgive our sin. Even while we are his enemies, he loves us and wants us to have his forgiveness. He can do this because he did something about our sin when he died on the cross. He took our place. He died for us. Let's all take a few moments in reflection and silent prayer, admitting our part and asking for his forgiveness.
The second word. The suffering of Jesus continued, but still he did not think about himself. He only thought of others. This time, it was the man next to him on the cross. One of the criminals had joined in with the mockers and made fun of Jesus. He said, "Aren't you not the Messiah? Save yourself and us." But the other rebuked him, saying, "Do you not fear God, since you are under the same sentence of condemnation? And we indeed have been condemned justly, for we are getting what we deserve for our deeds. But this man has done nothing wrong." Then he said, "Jesus, remember me when you come into your kingdom." Because Jesus could see the response of faith in this man's heart, he turned toward him and promised, "Truly I tell you, today you will be with me in paradise." At this moment, a feeling of joy must have eased the pain in the body of Jesus. Here is the first of many who would see the dying Savior and believe. The Bible tells us there is joy in heaven over every sinner who repents, no matter at what time of life the repentance takes place. The love of Jesus is so great, it can cover the worst life of sin and make us fit to dwell in heaven with God forever.
Third word. Mary, the mother of Jesus, was there at the foot of the cross that day. What would become of her now that her son was being put to death? Mary had been a wonderful mother to Jesus. Now she showed her love for him by being with him in this hour of agony and death. It isn't easy watching someone you love suffer. It must have been difficult for Jesus to know that his mother had to suffer so much because of what was happening to him. Jesus noticed his faithful disciple John was there with Mary. John had always been like a brother to Jesus. Jesus knew he could count on John. Therefore, Jesus said to his mother, "Woman, here is your son." And to John, he said, "Here is your mother." In this touching scene, Jesus reveals the importance of caring for one another in times of tragedy and loss. He shows the importance of planning for those who depend on us in case we die. Nothing can remove the sorrow which the separation of death brings, but we are there for each other as the family of God.
The fourth word. It was getting on toward noon of the day of crucifixion. All morning the weather had been acting strangely, and now suddenly the sky became unnaturally dark, as though the sun refused to shine as sin did its worst. It stayed that way until 3 o'clock that afternoon when Jesus died. It was such a strange and heavenly darkness. People became uneasy and wondered what it meant. Suddenly a cry from the middle cross pierced the darkness as Jesus cried out, my God, why have you forsaken me? Do you know why Jesus said that? It was because he was alone with our sin, with all the sin of the world. It was the moment of his greatest agony. The physical suffering was beyond description. But being forsaken by God was the ultimate pain, the ultimate experience of being alone. Because Jesus died alone for our sin, you and I are no longer need ever to feel forsaken by God, our Heavenly Father. If we trust in Jesus our Savior, God has promised to be with us always, no matter what, how dark life may become. Even in the darkness of death, when we seem to be all alone, separated from those we love, even with we are not alone, Jesus is at our side.
The fifth word. Jesus had been on the cross now for the better part of 6 hours. Among his pains was the pain of extreme thirst. Though Jesus had earlier refused a drink, he now cried out, "I am thirsty." Jesus was completely helpless. He had to depend on human beings to care for his simplest needs, even to get a drink for him. Imagine God begging. Jesus, who had made the oceans and the seas and the lakes and the rivers, begging for a few drops of water. This gives us a good idea of how much our Lord lowered himself so that we could have the water of life for our soul. It also reminds us of how important the death of Jesus is for our salvation and how much he thirsts for our response of love and faithfulness.
Mm-hmm. The sixth word. A soldier who stood near the cross heard Jesus' cry of thirst. He may not have understood Jesus because Jesus spoke in Aramaic and the soldier was Roman. Perhaps he assumed that Jesus was crying out because of pain. In any case, the soldier took a sponge, filled it with vinegar or sour wine, and put it on a stick and lifted it to the mouth of Jesus. This was meant to deaden the senses a little and thus reduce pain. When Jesus had received the wine, he said, "It is finished." These were wonderful words, perhaps the most wonderful words ever spoken. Jesus has finished the work on earth he had come to do. What a comfort to know that in what appeared to be the ultimate defeat of God's plan for the world, Jesus was a resounding success as our Savior. These words tell us that Jesus did everything that needs to be done. Our salvation has been won. Our hope of heaven is secured.
The seventh word. It was all over with rather quickly after this. Jesus' work was complete. Perhaps now he was anxious to die. He would leave his life in the hands of God, who had most carefully planned this day. Father, into your hands I commend my spirit. Immediately after this seventh and final word, Jesus bowed his head and died. Immediately, things began to happen. The sacred curtain in the temple split from top to bottom. There was an earthquake. Rocks split, graves were opened, and the bodies of the saints who had already died were revived and came back to life. They walked into the city and showed themselves to many people. Even the rough Roman captain, when he saw the way Jesus died and all that was happening, praised God and said, "Certainly this man was innocent." Now there was a good and righteous man named Joseph. Though a member of the council, he had not agreed to their plan of action. He came from the Jewish town of Arimathea, and he was waiting expectantly for the kingdom of God. This man went to Pilate and asked for the body of Jesus. He took Jesus' body down, wrapped it in a linen cloth, and laid it in a rock-hewn tomb where no one had ever been laid. It was the day of the preparation, and the Sabbath was beginning. The women who had come with him from Galilee followed, and they saw the tomb and how Jesus' body was laid. Then they returned and prepared spices and ointments. On the Sabbath, they rested according to the commandment from John chapter 23.
After our closing prayer, the tenebrae ends as we sing "Jesus, Remember Me" three times. After the singing, you are welcome to linger in silence or depart. Let us pray. O Lamb of God, you have taken away the sin of the world. Our hearts are bowed in reverence before the wonder of your cross. You have borne our griefs and carried our sorrows. With your stripes, we are healed. And God has laid on you the iniquity of us all. By your obedience, the betrayal and forsaking, the scourge and piercing crown, the cruel wounding of the nails, the taunts and burning thirst, the lingering anguish of the cross which you willingly endured for our salvation, grant us your pardon and your peace. Through dying, you have conquered death, and through your resurrection, we share your life forevermore. Crucified and risen Lord, draw us to yourself in true repentance and faith, and so motivate us to live lives that bear witness to your love. In your name we pray. Amen.
Jesus. Jesus, remember.